You will be faster than they are, stronger, quicker to sense corruption, and with full sanction to destroy it. You will be girded in the armor of gods and carry the blades of ruin. You will never age, never wither, never weary. And yet, in all of this, what remains your greatest gift? Only this. While you are a brotherhood, you are unbreakable. While you form the shield wall, guarding your packmates as if they were your own kinblood, you cannot be resisted. Solely by treachery can this power be undone. As we have learned, we emerge from the lesson stronger, tempered by the knowledge of how low our species can sink. We now know what waits for us should we fail, and that is well, for it is better to know your enemy's face than for it to remain hidden by shadow. Never forget this. When night comes again, as it surely will, only your brotherhood will protect you. Preserve it, and you will endure. Let it fracture, let it fail, and I tell you truly, our time, humanity's time, will be over.
The Legiones Astartes would be founded to bring compliance to the galaxy and unite the disparate fragments of humanity's past civilizations. Warriors of peerless martial skill would be crafted to destroy the enemies of the burgeoning Imperium and raise human worlds to the glory of the Emperor. Yet some among the civilizations of the galaxy would refute their allegiance to the Emperor and incur the wrath of the Master of Mankind. For today, we shall elucidate the executioners of the Emperor, raised from a death world of harsh ice storms and feral beasts. The Rout of Fenris, the Space Wolves. Since its inception, the Sixth Legion would be set apart from its peers. Alike to the Trefoil 18th and 20th Legions, the Sixth would be created to fulfill a specific, uncompromising task. Extermination. Prowling the wars of unification as a force of unrelenting violence and brutal shock assaults, the Sixth Legion would rightly be feared for the ruin left in their wake. These Astartes were not diplomats, builders, nor sentinels. They were killers, drawn from the most violent Terran civilizations on an individual basis. Bred not for malevolence, such as the Eighth, nor bloodthirst alike to the Twelfth, but instilled with the sanction of the Emperor to carry out his will. Caring not for pageantry, martial perfection, or glory, the Sixth Legion would find purpose in their duty to serve the Master of Mankind. Though little is known of their deeds during the unification of Terror, all that is worth noting is their unflinching obedience to the Emperor and lack of survivors able to speak of their bloody campaigns. Recruitment would be hazardous due to the Legion's candidates rejecting gene seed implantation at extremely high percentages, with deployment of the Sixth Legion being minimal during the era preceding the Great Crusade. The deployment of the Sixth Legion would be minimal during the era preceding the Great Crusade. Collared for a Terran standard decade during the dawn of the Great Crusade, the Legion would be unleashed upon the technologically advanced world of Delsvaan. Despite the civilization's proficient governance and military, the people of Delsvaan would be no match for the fury of the Sixth Legion, led by its Lord Commander, Enoch Rathin. Deploying every member of the Legion within a single overwhelming strike, within an hour of their descent onto the planet, the defenders would be cut down without mercy or restraint. For their swift and proven compliance, the Emperor would grant the Sixth Legion the 115th Expeditionary Fleet to enact further compliances across the galaxy. Serving alongside their brother legions, due to their smaller numbers ranging between 7,000 to 9,000 Astartes, the Sixth Legion would be dispatched as deadly shock troopers across hundreds of campaigns. Referred to as the Rout by their peers as a derogative term referring to jackals preying on the weak carrion of battle. Yet with the scattering of the Primarchs across the galaxy, it would not be long until the Sixth Legion would be reunited with their Genefather, and a new dawn would hearken the renewal of their Legion. Upon the world of Fenris, a child would be found having been raised by the apex predator of the Death World, a Fenrisian wolf. Surviving the harsh ice world alongside the cubs of the wolf, Geri and Freki, the infant Primarch would be found by the warriors of the Fenrisian tribe of the Rus. The wolf mother would be slain, to which the young Primarch would fell many warriors of the Rus with his bare hands to protect his surviving wolfkin. Realizing the feral beast to be human, the tribesmen would bring the young Primarch to their liege, King Thengir. Seeing great potential in the young boy, Thengir would adopt him into his household. Naming him Leman of the Rus, the young boy would quickly learn the customs of his tribe, mastering speech and proficiency with an assortment of weapons. Following the teachings of Gnariel, the Eldar of the Rus, the saga known as the Ascension of the Wolf King would endure as the eponymous tale of Leman's youth. A boy born of Hellwinter, raised by wolves, would form the basis for the Legion's future adoption of storytelling and reverence of Fenrisian culture. Leman would begin to conquer the rival tribes of the Death World as the Rus tribe expanded to become the single most powerful tribe of the planet. Yet Thengir, now ancient by the standards of the populace of Fenris, would be a rare soul to perish due to old age. Leman would be installed as the leader of the Rus tribe and continue his quest to unite his homeworld. Coming close to succeeding in his conquest, Leman would be given the title of Wolf King, and with time, reunite with the Master of Mankind during the early years of expanse of the Imperium. Alongside his brother, Horus Lupercal, Leman Rus would be among the first Primarchs to assume leadership of his Legion and embark across the stars. For many glories would be won by the Vilka Fenrica of Fenris, though much of their deeds would be misconstrued. Reunited with their Genefather, the Sixth Legion would assume a new title befitting the command of the Barbarian King of Fenris. Within weeks of the Emperor's tutelage of the Wolf King, he would be installed to command the now Space Wolves of the Legiones Astartes. Bristling at the crude epitaph appointed by ignorant bureaucrats, the Sky Warriors of Rus would stalk the stars as a predatory force gifting death and destruction to any who would incur their wrath. Quickly recruiting aspirants of Fenrisian birth into the Legion, the cultural trappings of the Vilka Fenrica would stir tension among the Terran veterans of the Sixth. Forged in blood and fire, the rout would earn a reputation as reliable exterminators of both Xenos and mutants across the galaxy. With the unification of more Primarchs into the fold of the Imperium, the Space Wolves would prove eager to aid their cousin legions in joint campaigns to purge the Imperium's enemies. Aiding the Iron Warriors and White Scars Legion during the Wheel of Fire campaign, the warriors of the Legiones Astartes would purge the Orc War of Mashog over the expanse of 5 years of conflict. Losing a third of their number during the campaign, the Legion would lose their first master, Enoch Ravin, and the Vilka Fenrica would renew their brotherhood through the Crucible of Sacrifice. Bloodlust would give way to discipline. Rage would be subsumed by duty, and pride would swell within the hearts of the Sons of Rus. Safeguarding humanity as the fangs clenched around the throats of its enemies. Fierce and cunning warriors all, the Rout would not tolerate defiance of their so-called Allfather, nor the betrayal of his vision for the future. Purging the galaxy clean for 2 centuries, the Vilka Fenrica would stand ready for any enemies skulking in the dark corners of the Void. Yet in their haste to enforce the Master of Mankind's will, the Sixth Legion would be pawns in the manipulations of an impending threat from within. The Space Wolves Legion had always harbored resentment and disgust towards the 15th Legion the Thousand Suns. Dabblers in the tides and currents of the warp, such powers would bear the taint of malevolence, to which the rout would decry its manipulations and embrace. Coming close to annihilating the Sons of Magnus the Red during their joint campaign on the world of Shrike. Witnessing the flesh change of members of the Thousand Suns, Leman would demand the 15th Legion to relinquish their abuses of the warp or suffer the wrath of the rout. Though hostilities would cease with the intervention of the Wordbearer's Primarch, Lorgar Aurelion, the continued scrutiny placed on the Thousand Suns would only postpone their censure. The Master of Mankind would convene the Council of Nicaea, a debate to decide the fate of the use of Psykers within the Legiones Astartes. Allying with the Death Guard and other detractors of the Librarius, the Space Wolves would proffer their accounts of witnessing the mutations within the Legion and demand reprisal. The Emperor would concede to the warning of the detractors of the Librarius and decree that all use of Psykers within the Legiones Astartes would be outlawed. Magnus the Red would stew in his Legion censure, yet mere years later, embark upon a great journey within the Immaterium to prevent catastrophe. Horus Lupercal, Warmaster of the Imperium, would fall to the clutches of Chaos and begin to enact his grand betrayal of the Imperium. Magnus would intervene in an attempt to prevent the Lupercal's surrender to the manipulations of Chaos, yet fail to prevent his downfall. Projecting his soul to Holy Terror to warn the Emperor of the impending betrayal, Magnus would consort with demons of the warp to breach the Imperial Palace's psychic wards. Breaching the psychic barrier surrounding the Emperor's throne room, Magnus would damn humanity to forever voyage across the Immaterium in their traversal across the stars. For his heinous act of irreparable damage to the Emperor's Webway project, the Master of Mankind would dispatch the Sixth Legion to bring the Thousand Suns to Terra for judgment. Yet the War Master of the Ruinous Powers would see an opportunity to sow further chaos. Intercepting the orders given to the rout, Horus would command Leman Russ to exterminate the Thousand Suns upon their homeworld of Prospero. Already rumored to have driven one of the redacted legions to extinction, the Emperor's executioner would revel in the task to bring the most despised legion to heel. Incorporating members of the Sisters of Silence and Legio Custodes into the fold of his fleet, the Wolf King would travel to the Thousand Suns' homeworld. Prospero would burn as the Vilka Fenrica butchered the Thousand Suns en masse. For a time, Magnus the Red would allow for his people's persecution in order to prevent their manipulation by the ruinous powers, yet relent under the advisements of his first captain, Arzek Araman. The two kings of war would duel, one fighting for the love of his sons, the other for the duty to his father. Leman would fatally wound the Crimson King, yet Magnus would submit himself to the patronage of the Changer of Ways, Sinch, to ensure the retreat of his legion. The rout had decimated Prospero, yet by the manipulations of the warp, its capital city, Tizca, would be transported to the Eye of Terra and come to rest upon the cursed planet of the sorcerers. Russ had failed to exterminate the last remnants of the 15th, yet be oblivious to the betrayal of his once stalwart brother, Horus. Assembling his remaining might to the Alaxus Nebula, the rout would be trapped by the agents of the Warmaster, the Alpha Legion. Already battle-weary from Prospero, the Vilka Fenrica would brace themselves as the snare of the Hydra tightened. Alpharius Omegon, already embittered towards the Wolf King for his dismissal of the 20th Legion's use of subterfuge and trickery, would relish the chance to humble the wolves of Fenris. Petitioning aid from the White Scars Legion, the Primarch of the Fifth, Jagatai Khan, would refuse to engage in the conflict until answers were gleaned as to the intent of the rout and its allegiances. Alone, Russ would ruminate on his circumstance and the conflict he now found his legion embroiled within. With counsel from the young pack leader of Tra, Bjorn the One-Handed, Leman would resolve to reforge his purpose as the Emperor's executioner, as the Wolf King rallied his men in an attempt to break from the Hydra's fleet. Seemingly confronted by the Primarch of the Alpha Legion, Leman would defend the flagship of the Space Wolves, Harafnakel, until the arrival of the Dark Angels Legion. Unaware of the wider conflict of the Horus Heresy, a servant of the Regent of Caliban, Captain Ormand, would dispatch one of his men to infiltrate the rout to ascertain their allegiance in the conflict. Discovered by the Rune Priest, Kvar, the Dark Angel would nonetheless deem the Sixth Legion loyal to the Imperium and aid them in routing the fleeing Alpha Legion fleet. Sending a distress call, the Dark Angel's fleet of Lufa would drive back the Alpha Legion, led by their commander, Chapter Master Alphalos. Freed from the Hydra's grip, the Space Wolves would return to the Throne World to aid in the defense of the Imperium. Yet Leman would not stay idle upon Terra for long, as he began to orchestrate his last attempt to slay his corrupted brother. Convening with Malkador the Sigilite, the Wolf King would seek counsel from his ancient mentor, as well as the Knight Errant, formerly of the Lunar Wolves Legion, Garviel Oaken. The Sigilite had attempted to assassinate Horus on several occasions, yet never with a Primarch wielding the blade. Dispatching his Knight's Errant to infiltrate the War Master's flagship, the Vengeful Spirit, during its journey to Holy Terra, the strike team led by Garviel Oaken would mark the path for the impending assault of the Space Wolves. Assisted by the former Astartes of the rout, Broad Tearfinger, the Knight's Errant would lay Fufark rings within the vast Gloriana-class voidship to allow the rout swift infiltration of the Lupercal's court. Retreating from the engagement aboard the ship, Tarnhelm, the Knight's Errant would return to Holy Terra, with exception given to Braw as he rejoined the rout in their assault of the War Master's flagship. Armed with the Dionysian spear, crafted by the Emperor's own hand, Leman Russ would confront the War Master and attempt to end his madness. Piercing his armor and skin with the tip of the spear's blade, Horus's body would be cleansed of the corrupting influence of the ruinous powers. Yet Horus would remain resolute in his defiance of the Emperor, with the visions of the grim dark future, gifted by the dark gods, still plaguing his mind. Leman would be wounded, and with the aid of his sons, be carried from the battle before being slain by the War Master. Horus would partially recover from his grievous wound and its afflicted coma, embarking to Holy Terra to enact his final siege of the Throne World. Yet the Space Wolves would not be present during the final battle to save the soul of humanity. Regrouping and venturing with all haste to Holy Terra, the Vilka Fenrica would arrive too late to prevent the War Master's duel with the Emperor and interment of the Master of Mankind upon the Golden Throne. The battle had been won in the name of the Imperium, yet at a cost which would damn humanity to millennia of suffering, strife, and degeneration. Leman would be stricken with grief for his failure to prevent the loss of his father and so many stalwart defenders of the Imperium. Bolstering the loyalist counterattack of the Great Scouring of the Traitors, the rout would hunger for vengeance against the now humbled Champions of Chaos. Spearheading the charge to drive the traitors back into the Eye of Terra, the Space Wolves and their Primarch would purge their number for 7 Terran standard years until their task would be fulfilled. Yet Leman Russ would not stand idle as the embers of betrayal gathered to one day rekindle across the stars. For he would leave the Space Wolves under the command of Bjorn the One-Handed and embark on a quest to revivify the Imperium. A quest he shall not return from until the commencement of the end of days, the Wolf Time. For 7 years after the disappearance of the Wolf King, the Wolves of Fenris would wait patiently for the return of their liege. Electing Bjorn as the first great wolf of the rout, the now fell-handed would leave his legion on a great hunt to seek out their Primarch. Venturing far and wide across the Sea of Stars, the Space Wolves would find no trace of their Gene Father, even within the roiling tides of the Eye of Terra. Bjorn would be wounded and interred within a dreadnought sarcophagus as the Great Hunt bore only ill omens and tales of woe. Several great hunts would follow as the years waxed and waned, with the second hunt claiming the armor of Rus from the Temple of Horus on the planet of Rudra, and ninth leading to the purge of a world under the thrall of the cults of the Devourer. For each great hunt bears great deeds, and even should they not facilitate clues to their liege lord's return, all serve as campaigns fought for the preservation and benefit of the Imperium. Bestowed by visions of the Rune Priests, said to be voiced by their Primarch, the Providence of Leman Rus guides the Now Chapter to embark on great hunts to hasten his return. Believing the end of days to be impending, the Space Wolves identify campaigns such as Abaddon the Despoiler's destruction of Cadia during his accursed 13th Black Crusade, and resurgence of the Loyalist Primarch, Rabute Gilliman, to be signs of the Wolf Time. Rumors stir that the Lion of Caliban now stalks the stars once more, confronting the Champions of Chaos wherever they spawn. Yet should the Wolf of Fenris add his claws and fangs to the fray, the schemes and plots of the ruinous powers shall continue to be abated. To be recruited into the Vilka Fenrica is one of the most grueling trials of any Space Marine chapter. Drawing aspirants solely from the tribesmen of Fenris, the neophytes of the Sixth are required to endure the harsh environments of the Death World in their quest to slay a beast of the frigid wastelands. Armed with the barest of furs, tools, and weapons, the recruits must bring a fang of their kill to prove their mettle. Observed by the chapter's wolf priests, the fatality rate of the aspirants is incredibly high, with most never passing their first trial to ascend to the ranks of the Astartes. Yet for those proven to adapt to their environment, endure the suffering inflicted by the bitter cold, and dominate the deadliest predators of the planet, they shall earn a brief reprieve before being tested in further trials. Inducted into the training camps of Rusvik, Volksburg, and Grimnir, the aspirants shall be banded as so-called Wolf Brothers and further test their abilities in packs of ad hoc squadrons. For the Space Wolves, the pack is of paramount importance for the methods of war waged by the Sixth, and so each neophyte must hone their proficiency in cooperation to fulfill their tasks. Dispatched once more into the wastes of Azaheim, the Wolf Brothers shall face the feral beasts of Fenris once more, and should they succeed, ascend to the rank of Bloodclaws. Finally, each proven neophyte must undertake the trials of Morkai. First, they shall be brought before a council of Rune Priests, who shall test their mental resolve by harnessing the strange arcanum of Fenris. Within the bowels of the Space Wolves Fortress Monastery, the Ayat, also known as the Fang, a portal surrounded by rivers of molten lava, must be passed. Walking through the ancient archway, centered with the Wolf God's image as a symbol of his commitment to embark into the jaws of danger. Unburdened of weakness, the aspirants' minds shall be scoured by the Rune Priests for any signs of doubt, temptation, or fear. Conjuring phantom foes and the deepest-rooted fears of the aspirants, only those who steel themselves against their plight shall succeed. Those who fail shall be mind-wiped and gifted to the chapter's Iron Priests to undergo lobotomies and surgeries to become servitor thralls of the Sixth. Once screened for signs of vulnerability, those who prove pure in their purpose shall undertake the final trial of Morkai. The Blooding shall test the neophytes as they drink from the cup of the Wolfen. A relic of the chapter, the cup allows the drinker to absorb the Canis Helix of their gene seed, or Spirit of the Wolf, to act as a catalyst to activate their gene floor. Many shall writhe in uncontrollable agony as their bodies are racked by the deadly transformation, as some even succumb to the mutations. Cast back into the wilderness, those who survive must find their way back to the Fang, as his body increases up to 80% larger, as his muscles painfully burgeon with muscle growth. Bones fuse, fangs sprout from his gums, and for those who prove unfortunate, they shall transform into feral beasts, cursed to roam the wastes of Fenris. Those who reject the curse of the Wolfen shall return to the Eät as a true Sky Warrior of the Rout. Gifted the power armor of a fallen battle brother of the chapter, the newly ascended Astartes shall be placed into one of the 12 great companies as a true Son of Rus. The curse of the Wolfen still plagues many of the aspirants whom have succeeded in their trials of Morkai. Activated under intensely stressful engagements, the Canis Helix can lay dormant for decades or even centuries without stirring. As a clear flaw of the Space Wolves' gene seed, it is a testament to the value of the Rout that those who uncover their dark secret do not seek censure from the Imperium regarding their mutations. Naturally aloof and distant in their dealings, the administrators of the Imperium are content to allow the Space Wolves to slay the enemies of humanity unhindered, so long as their campaigns do not interfere with their own dealings. Obedient and intensely loyal, the Sixth's bellicose and strange nature allows for deflection of intense scrutiny by way of capitalizing on the ignorance of onlookers. Savage warriors, lauded for countless great victories and campaigns throughout the millennia, the Canis Helix, while a great flaw in its inherent risk of mutation, nonetheless allows the Vilka Fenrica to persecute warfare with unmatched primal fury. Incredibly adept hunters and trackers, the reputation of their Primarch and Legion as executioners and killers is well earned. Though millions have perished during the trials of recruitment into the Sixth, the prestige of those few who survive are legendary, even among the Adeptus Astartes. Those who transform into the Wolfen are captured by the senior officers of the chapter and caged as feral beasts. Unleashed upon the most desperate of battles, the Wolfen tear their foes limb from limb as deadly cannon fodder, who even in their bestial state serve the will of the chapter. A notable yet arbitrary flaw, also inherent in the gene seed of the Rout, is their proclivity to show signs of aging. Unlike most Astartes, the hair of the veterans of the chapter shall turn grey as their canines lengthen and their skin becomes leathery. Regarded as grey hunters, the most venerable Astartes of many centuries of service grow fangs more alike to tusks in size and are known as Longfangs. Elders of the chapter of the highest esteem, the Longfangs have harnessed and mastered their inherent darkness of the Wolfen and are granted wills of iron for their continual, indomitable nature. As a non-codex compliant chapter of the Adeptus Astartes, the Space Wolves have retained their organization of its great companies, each championed by their respective wolf lords and comprised of an average of 150 to 200 Astartes. The Bloodmoors are led by Bran Redmoor and are masters of hunting. Their icon of the Bloodied Hunter represents their savagery in battle, for it is said that the curse of the Wolfen is especially prevalent in the ranks of the Bloodmoors. Cunning warriors, comprising several grey hunters among their ranks, the warriors of the Bloodied Hunter lie in wait to tear their foes limb from limb. The Seawolves are led by Engir Krakendum and brandish the Seawolf upon their armor. Drawn from the southern islands of Fenris's Kraken Hunters, Engir's men specialize in armored warfare and champion the use of Swiftclaw Outriders to cast a tide of bloodshed across their enemies. The Sons of Morkai are led by Eric Morkai and bear the two-headed beast as their sigil. Stern and indomitable scouts, the Sons of Morkai approach warfare with cold and mirthless duty. Deployed en masse in carapace armor and relinquishing any use of Terminators within their ranks, the mobile and violent Great Company, comprised of approximately 100 warriors, prefer rapid maneuvers and infiltration. The Red Moons, led by Gunnar Redmoon, embody their patron's visage of a skeletal beast devouring the bodies of its unworthy foes. Favoring aggressors and heavy firepower, these hulking warriors are less wolves and more appropriately alike to bears in their methods of unleashing massive casualties. The Death Wolves, led by Harald Deathwolf, adopt the Ravening Jaw icon, depicting Morkai devouring the sun and plunging the galaxy into eternal darkness. Master tamers of beasts, The warriors of the Death Wolf charge into battle atop Thunderwolves and lupine creatures of both biological and mechanical construction. The Stormwolves, led by Bjorn Stormwolf, adopt the Great Thunderwolf as their symbol. Impetuous and impatient warriors, the Stormwolves eschew stealth to better take to the field of battle upon Vindicators and Speedbikes to clash against their foes without relent. The Iron Wolves, led by Vorek Gnarlfist, bear the Iron Wolf as their sigil and deploy metallic beasts and armored divisions to rampage across the ranks of their enemies. Cutting off escape routes and supply lines, the Iron Wolves bleed their enemies dry with the purity and reliable essence of the machine. The Drake Slayers, led by Crom Dragongaze, embody the nature of the Sun Wolf. Bearing a steely glare and immense reputation for earned glories, the Drake Slayers are among the most deadly and prestigious great companies of the Space Wolves. The Fire Howlers, led by Sven Bloodhowl, tattoo their skin with their icon of the Fire Breather, but also runes and sagas of their past deeds. Bereft of their leader during their battle against the Blackstone Fortress, Will of Eternity, the Fire Howlers remain vigilant for their Wolf Lord's return and earn glory for their great company as they tattoo their deeds upon their remaining canvas of their skin. The Grimblood, led by Kjarl Grimblood, bear the sigil of the Fire Wolf and are rumored to bear guilt for their heraldry. Said to read the future, Kjarl Grimblood executes the will of his chapter with purging flamer weapons to facilitate the future portents best suited to the survival of the chapter. The Blackmanes, led by Ragnar Blackmane, have earned legendary renown for their campaigns. Leading entire planetary invasions via drop pod assault, the young Wolf Lord, despite his age, has been proven to be an Astartes of singular providence. The second largest great company, the Blackmanes comprise many Skyclaws, Swiftclaws, and Bloodclaws into their ranks of many of the junior Astartes of the chapter. Hungering to prove themselves in battle, the Blackmanes bring immense pride to the chapter for their continued successful campaigns and reputation as warriors of unimpeachable skill. And finally, the Great Wolf's Company contains the single most revered veterans of the chapter. The Champions of Fenris, imbued with boundless courage and honor, wear the honorific of the wolf that stalks between stars, proudly upon their armor. Previously known as the Night Runners, it is the decision of each member as to which sigil they shall bear upon their pauldron. The largest of all the great companies, the Champions of Fenris fight alongside their great wolf, with the Kingsguard acting as the chapter master's personal bodyguards. Specialists such as the Shield Brothers and Void Claws fight in close quarters as the most proficient melee warriors of the chapter. For it is truly a sight to behold, to see the greatest warriors of the rout brought to bear. The Wolf's emblem of the Sixth Legion has become a hallmark of Imperial legend as a symbol to be feared by its enemies. Black on yellow, with occasional ornamentation of runes and silver diamonds, the symbol of the former Legion is worn only by the Great Company of the Blackmanes, as the wider chapter eschew its use, with the Astartes replacing its pride of place with the icon of their respective great company. Denoting their ranks by use of Fenrisian markings, with the promotion of each Wolf Lord as leader of their respective wolf pack, the markings are changed by his decree to reflect his personal choosing. Formal identifiers are not widespread due to the chapter's nonconformist nature, yet slight variations of each icon of the great companies are designed. None may alter the appearance of the sigil of the Great Wolf, the wolf that stalks between stars, for such an act would dishonor the memory of its original bearer, Leman Russ. For no man shall dare revoke the iconography of the Wolf King, and as such, many of the chapter's relics still bear its original heraldry, unchanged by centuries of war. Inscribing honor markings upon their ceramite, displays of courage, kinship, and glorious deeds are commonplace among the Astartes of the Rout. From ancient runes to stylistic symbols of Fenrisian origins, though no formal conventions exist outlining their use, every Astartes of the chapter enshrines such sigils with great reverence and pride. Icons such as bones represent wounds endured in battle, while knife and claw markings denote bravery in the most deadly of battles. Marching into battle, donned in gunmetal grey during the days of unification and until the end of the Horus Heresy, the Space Wolves now adopt a blue-tinged grey paint scheme. Adorned with great pelts of Fenrisian beasts, red and yellow jewels, and necklaces of teeth, the only stringent ruling of their heraldry is that their wolf pack placement upon their right pauldron and great company upon their left. Some also mark their knee guard with the symbol of their wolf pack, yet due to the highly individualistic nature of each Astartes, must define his own methods of honoring his kin. Although the inheritors of the Sixth Legion do not ascribe to the conventions or rulings of the wider Imperium, they are strict adherents to the hierarchies of their own culture. Led by their great wolf, the equivalent rank of Chapter Master, acts as the steward of the rout until the return of the Wolf King, Leman Russ. Chosen from among the Wolf Lords of the Chapter, only the most battle-hardened members of the Vilka Fenrica assume the most prestigious mantle of the rout, to which its current custodian, Logan Grimnar, has held the title for 8 centuries. The Wolf Lords bear ranks comparable to Adeptus Astartes captains. Leading each of the 12 great companies into battle, the Wolf Lords are each accompanied by Wolf Guards. Though a prestigious rank among the rout, it is not expected of the Wolf Lords to live long lives due to the chapter's proclivity to fight in close combat engagements. Yet such is the strength of the Wolf Lords that some within their ranks have exceeded 1,000 years of war in service to their chapter. The Iron Priests oversee the forges of the Space Wolves and serve alike to Tech Marines of the chapter. Assigned to the Great Wolf's company, the Champions of Fenris, when required, the Iron Priests are dispatched to other fighting deployments and companies to meet the needs as tactical analysts during battle. Wolf Priests serve as both apothecaries and chaplains of the Space Wolves. Ministering the spiritual and medical needs of the rout, the Wolf Priests also bear the responsibility to identify and induct aspirants into the chapter to undergo the trials to become a Space Marine. Rune Priests act as the librarians of the Vilka Fenrica, yet balk at the insinuation that their powers are drawn from the warp. Drawing power from the so-called Underverse, the Rune Priests rarely bear psychic hoods or traditional weapons associated with the psychers of the Adeptus Astartes. Armed with runic weapons, the peculiar wielders of their rune-drawn powers memorize the oral traditions and deeds of their chapter to be passed down from generation to generation. Battle leaders command elements of the chapter's might alike to Adeptus Astartes' lieutenants. Chosen to mentor younger members of the chapter or serve as personal bodyguards of their respective wolf lords, the battle leaders are an integral senior rank within the rout. Role models within the Vilka Fenrica, the battle leaders lead several packs of Space Marines as they wage war to prove themselves worthy of ascension to the role of future wolf lords. Pack leaders are the equivalent of sergeants within the rout and lead 10-man squads into battle. The humblest of senior ranks within the chapter, it is the rank of pack leader, which begins a Space Wolf's journey through the ranks to glory. Dreadnoughts of the chapter are both devastating warriors and wise counselors. Veterans of thousands of battles, the venerable dreadnoughts sleep under the fortress monastery of the Ayat until they are awoken for counsel or battle in the chapter's direst hours. Though the Contemptor Pattern dreadnought chassis has earned contempt from the chapter due to its reputation for savagery and bloodlust. With even rarer cases of some wolfen being interred within dreadnought sarcophagi, the inheritors of the Canis Helix bound into battle only should the need for remorseless butchery be required. Known for their savagery throughout the Imperium, the rout stand apart from the original founding legions in their distinct violent battle strategies. Issuing organization in deference to individual martial prowess, each pack of the Sixth transforms from impatient and bloodthirsty berserkers to wise and revered veterans. Once comprised of over 73,000 Astartes, the now chapter of the Adeptus Astartes, whilst not compliant to the ruling of 1000 outlined by the Codex Astartes, has nonetheless diminished from its former size. Anti-authoritarian to their core, the Rout comply only with the will of their elders within the chapter as a source of command. Abandoning methods of war deemed superfluous to their means, the Space Wolves only retain strategies of their peers, proven to bolster their brutal methods of warfare. Divided into wolf packs of 10 Astartes, each member of these squads are formed of brothers in arms whom have shared many campaigns. Adept at working together through bonds of camaraderie, the Astartes' enhanced sense of smell and kinship enable such wolf packs to locate their peers once separated from the pack. Never reinforcing losses within each pack, each brotherhood must survive or be forgotten as a footnote in the chapter's history. For only proven wolf packs shall be honored by the Skalds in the storied tales of the Sixth. Bloodclaws are the most junior of the wolf packs, comprised of the equivalent of assault marines used by other chapters. The aggressive neophytes wage war to prove themselves worthy of ascension through the ranks of the Sixth. The Swift Claws are a derivative of the Blood Claws, specializing in hit-and-run, targeted assaults. Charging into battle atop land speeders and assault bikes, the young and ambitious Astartes take no heed for their own self-preservation in their rampage to prove their might. The Sky Claws are also a subset of the Blood Claws, serving as the chapter's assault marines. Equipped with jump packs, these headstrong killers swarm their enemies from above and crash among their enemies' ranks, wreaking havoc via melee weaponry. Tempering the most rebellious of the chapter through trial by fire, and allowing for failure or even death in their assaults, the Sky Claws must learn the cost of their impetuous nature. The Grey Hunters are seasoned veterans of the chapter and bear their title with pride. The equivalent of tactical marines among the Adeptus Astartes, the Grey Hunters are the most numerous squad configuration throughout the Sixth, and prove to be reliable and proud warriors to which their juniors should hope to one day aspire to. The Longfangs are the most senior of the wolf packs, formed of the elders of the chapter. Not to be underestimated for their age, the Longfangs, though grey of mane, nonetheless inspire awe in their kin for their unimpeachable deeds and ferocity in battle. It is a great honor for an Astartes of the Rout to survive long enough to ascend to the rank of Longfang, for only the most deadly and cunning warriors can evade death's embrace for so many centuries of war. The Wolf Guard are a specialist wolf pack responsible for the defense of the chapter's wolf lords. Each member a champion of the Vilka Fenrica, the members of the Wolf Guard can requisition any Astartes from the wolf packs to fight at their side and train prospective future members of their guard. Often clad in Terminator armor, the Wolf Guard are armed with the most sacred and powerful relics of the chapter, and fight at the vanguard of the deadliest conflicts, and may one day assume the mantle of Wolf Lord with their continued service. The Thunderwolf Cavalry are a subdivision of the Wolf Guard, and are a secret to outsiders of the chapter. Riding into battle upon Thunderwolves of prodigious size, the elite of the Wolf Guard augment their wolves with cybernetics to add to their terrifying demeanor. Charging into battle as waves of unstoppable killing fury, these warriors are deployed only in the most dire of battles, where a swift crippling of the enemy is required. The Wolf Scouts are masters of reconnaissance and are installed to each great company to enable proficiency in gathering intelligence and battlefield data. Not to be confused with neophytes of the chapter, the Wolf Scouts are veterans of war and prove adept at identifying weaknesses in their enemies' defenses and battle lines. The Lone Wolves are sole survivors of packs unfortunate enough to be annihilated during battle. Having not earned a place within the Wolf Guard, the Lone Wolves must battle alone to regain the honor of their fallen pack, or die as another casualty of their extinct brethren. Slaying dangerous foes and champions of the enemies of the Rout, those who prove their might shall be installed as members of the Wolf Guard. Finally, the Wolf Blades are an ancient honor guard dispatched to Holy Terra. Allied with the Navigator House of Belisarius, The Rout honor their alliance by installing Space Wolf Astartes to train the Celestarks of the Navigator House and defend their aristocracy as stalwart bodyguards. For there are few Navigator houses allied with chapters of the Adeptus Astartes, and to have members of the Sky Warriors of Fenris within their retinue retains their fierce reputation and dauntless pedigree. The Rout remain among the most controversial of all the chapters of the Adeptus Astartes, with many deriding their use of overwhelming, brutal force and rejection of the outlines of the Codex Astartes. Rivaled only by the Black Templars and Grey Knights in their autonomy, both the Emperor's Holy Inquisition and Adeptus Ministorum have failed on numerous occasions to restrain or shackle the Sons of Rus. Despite such misgivings, the Space Wolves have gained a reputation as arguably the single most capable and stalwart defenders of the Imperium, due to their countless battles against both Xenos and Chaos incursions. Led by their Great Wolf, Logan Grimnar, the Rout of the 41st Millennium has staved off the invasions of Abaddon the Despoiler for many years, and cost the War Master of Chaos many losses during his accursed 13th Black Crusade. Aiding War Master Lord Solar Macarius during the Macarian Crusade, the Space Wolves would recognize the legendary Astra Militarum commander's ambition, with the then Great Wolf, Ulrich Grimfang, sanctioning the aid of the Rout in his endeavors. Also of note would be the chapter's aid during the First War for Armageddon during 444.M41, alongside the stalwart human defenders in their defiance against the invasion of the forces of Chaos. With the intervention of the Grey Knights chapter under the command of the Inquisition, the war would be won, yet entail a heavy price. The populace would be ordered to submit for sterilization and drafting into work camps until exhausted to the point of death. Furious at Inquisitor Lord Kisneros's decision, the Space Wolves would defend the populace from the Grey Knights in a war which would come to be known as the Months of Shame. Millions would perish, with vital outposts and installations across the Armageddon system being annihilated by the embattled Astartes chapters. Survivors of the Armageddon system would escape as the Rout confronted the Grey Knights and ultimately deny the Inquisition their demands. Destroying Lord Kisneros's flagship, its destruction ending him in the process, the Space Wolves would slay the Supreme Grandmaster of the Grey Knights and demonstrate their reputation as a force not to be opposed. The Months of Shame would end and leave a legacy of mistrust and aggression towards the Inquisition. The only Astartes chapter with knowledge of the 666th without sanction, the Space Wolves now fire upon any Inquisition vessels seen within the Fenris system without their express permission, placing Chaos-emancipated civilizations such as Alaric Prime into their Wargeld or Chapter Protectorate to prevent their destruction by the Inquisition. The Space Wolves have earned a reputation as defenders of the downtrodden, despite their infamous savagery in battle. The Sixth Legion's traditions of storytelling, passed down through oral tradition, remain of great significance to the chapter. Each of the great companies are named after the wolves of Fenrisian mythology, with many assigned to a great company, encompassing their own lessons. The Black-maned Wolf is the most deadly of all the Fenrisian wolves, enshrining within the Space Wolves a deadly pedigree to aspire towards. The bloodied hunter stalks its prey and delights in the art of tracking and slaying its target. The Dark Wolf is the only one of the 12 to never howl. Lurking among the shadows, the Dark Wolf shepherds the spirits of the dead into their tombs to lie in wait to rise once more during the wolf time. Drekken the Thunder Wolf champions strength over subtlety and enables its devotees to gain the might required to sunder their enemies. The Fire Breather dwells in the grand volcanoes of Fenris, spewing its molten wrath when angered and tempering its adherents to unleash their fury when provoked. The Fire Wolf heralds the beginning of the season of fire upon Fenris as the Death World's ice and snow melts to give way and islands sink into the ocean to give rise to new landmasses. Whether the Firewolf hearkens the doom of Fenris or newfound glory varies with each season of fire. Freki and Geri, the twin wolves raised at the side of the Wolf King, Leman Russ, would serve alongside their brother during the Great Crusade. Representing the bond of brotherhood inherent within the Rout, the strength of the pack embodies the Rout's potential to defeat any foe through teamwork and camaraderie. The Great Devourer is an omen within the mythology of Fenris and bodes great times of immense destruction. Hyger, the Mountain Wolf, epitomizes the endurance of the Rout and their duty to embrace the hardships of their environment without complaint to enable the Space Wolves' continual improvement through discomfort and struggle. The Ice Wolf serves as a lieutenant of the Guardian of the Fenrisian Underworld, Morkai. The fiercest of Morkai's pack, the Ice Wolf would strike Leman Russ in their chronicled legends and be hurled by the Wolf King into the Eye of the Wolf, the sun in which Fenris orbits. Forging the fang of the Ice Wolf into a blade known as Svelvanda, the chapter relic reminds the adherents of the Ice Wolf to fight alike to the icy sting inflicted upon their Primarch in battles worthy of similar tales of glory. The Iron Wolf embodies the spirit of the chapter's iron priests and their forgers, teaching the Rout the value of craftsmanship, weaponsmithing, and the maintenance of their armaments. Lakan, the Runed Wolf, is the totem of the rune priests of the chapter and instills the value of the mysterious runecraft inscribed upon the Space Wolf Ceramite. Lokia, the Lone Wolf, bears the aspect of the Wolf Scouts of the chapter and teaches the chapter's fresh recruits the value of self-reliance. Rank, the Hidden Wolf, stalks the shadows and champions the virtues of stealth as a potent means to deal death. The Sea Wolf protects those who sail upon the vast oceans of Fenris, whilst the Sun Wolf arises each dawn within the heart of Fenris's sun to shine a light on the harsh death world. Thengir, the Wolf King, represents the Space Wolves' fortress monastery, the Thang, whilst the Night Runner marks the heraldry of the Great Wolf Logan Grimnar's glory. Torvald, the Farsighted, sees all upon Fenris and instructs young Space Wolf aspirants to analyze the state of battle before hurling themselves into the fray unprepared. The Spirit Wolf guards the souls of the Space Wolves and defends their spirits from the corrupting influence of Maleficarum. The Wolf of the Red Moon stalks the seven hells of Fenris and claims the deceased proven unworthy to enter Morkai. The wolf that stalks between stars is worn proudly by each and every great wolf to bear witness as each chaptermaster of the Rout brings glory to Fenris. Morkai, the twin-headed guardian, rules the Fenrisian underworld. Bested by Leman Russ during his arrival to Fenris, Morkai would be cast into the underworld by the Wolf King as penance. And finally, the Wolfen serves as the cursed, bestial nature of the Space Wolves. All sons of Russ must remain ever vigilant to reject the feral nature sown deep within their being. For should they surrender to its nature, they shall become corrupted, beasts of madness. Enshrined in the traditions of Fenrisian culture, the Space Wolves retell the sagas of their chapter. Tales of mighty heroes and terrible monsters instill pride within the young Astartes of the Rout. Distrustful of technology and sorceries not drawn from their homeworld, the peoples of Fenris, to which their Astartes are drawn, elevate honor and valor as the utmost virtues to achieve. Regarding their souls to be Freds, when a Space Marine of the Rout perishes, their battle brothers shall refer to their Fred being cut. Burning their bodies upon funeral pyres, his surviving brethren shall feast to his memory and retell the tales of his greatest deeds. Their revelries shall not end until each member of the Great Company espouses every worthy deed of their fallen battle brother, which can last for several days or even weeks. None may interrupt the feast, nor leave the confines of the feasting chamber until its conclusion, with the longest recorded feast lasting the retelling of 432 tales of Heyroth Longfang during the Great Crusade by the Company of Tra. Adopting deed names for their most vaunted glories, the Astartes of the Sixth eschew their former names, often to be replaced with names such as Thunderfist, Blackbrow, or Stormcaller. Warding evil spirits with the use of Eyes of Aversions, the Space Wolves shall carve such symbols upon the walls and structures of deadly enemy outposts to warn of grave danger. Though seen as superstitious by the wider Imperium, the practices of the chapter have regardless proven potently powerful, despite detractors sneering at their drawing from the pagan planetary essence of Fenris. Revering the runic divinations conjured by the chapter's rune priests, the Space Wolves analyze the casting of runes to glean portents of the future and omens impending upon the rout. Runes such as Aja, Hata, Trisk, Ymir, and Fingir encompass names such as blood, ice, and the wolf within, and tease clues as to the future that shall befall the Vilka Fenrica. For the wolf time approaches, with none able to decipher its true date. Yet when the end of day shall come, the Vilka Fenrica shall stand ready, led by their returned Primarch, to combat the final onslaught of the enemies of humanity.
It was the Old Father who created Leman Ras, the primogenitor of the Vilka Fenrica, and the Old Father who fashioned the legions to serve under his name. For every legion he created, there was a purpose. Some were blessed with the power to build, or the skill to administer, or the capacity for stealth. Our gift was different. We were made to destroy. Our whole being is destruction. Such was the will of the Old Father. He made us not to construct empires, but to murder them. We were bred to perform the tasks that no other legion could. To fight with such extravagance that even our brother warriors would shrink from treachery. In the knowledge of what we, the Rout, would do to them.
This has been a tale of the Great Imperium of Man, read by the Remembrancer. The Vilka Fenrica would serve with distinction as one of the most reliable and stubbornly defined chapters of the 41st millennium. Always at the forefront of the most deadly of battles, the Rout wage wars many other chapters would not have the constitution to survive. Yet in my next transmission, we shall elucidate a legion that blights the stars, ever rejecting the embrace of death. The Fallen Sons of Barbarus, the Death Guard.